since I'm still wearing my hat of an organizer, I wanted to use this opportunity to thank you all for coming here, although for some of you it wasn't easy, and also for being so active in making the school a vigorous event. Thank you. And on a more mundane note, if any of you need some kind of letter from ICTP for your home institution, which you need to show that you've been here, let me know and I will issue such a letter. All right, so Professor Kamenev raised the level of the discussion during his last lecture very high. I'm going to bring it down. I'm going to talk about very simple things. Professor Chubukov promised that I'm going to talk about a Drude model. I will. So if you have a feeling that you're back to your solid state one class, that's okay. My purpose would be to go through very basic stuff, emphasize certain pitfalls which one may run into even on this simple path, and then take it a little bit further and talk about the behavior of certain non-Fermi liquid metals. I'm not going to really split the lecture into Fermi liquids and non-Fermi liquids. I will bring in other material as we go. The first lecture is going to be PowerPoint mostly. The second lecture is going to be mostly Blackboard. Okay, so this is the idea of my Agidankian experiment. This is a Fermi liquid in here. And one way to measure it, just to stick in our context and to read what ohmmeter says. But I'll be also talking about another way of measuring conductivity, and this is the optical one. When you shine light on a sample and you measure the reflection R coefficient and then via some transformations, you get both the real and the imaginary part of the conductivity. This is a list of people with whom I collaborated many years on the subject of transport, and they're not responsible for anything I will tell you today, but they did help me to form my current somewhat poor understanding, and there is a subgroup of people which work with me or used to work with me at the University of Florida, and then I think the rest of them, you had a chance to see either during the workshop or during this week. Well, you certainly recognize this person here. Vladimir Yudson is on and off. I think I saw him. Okay, so he is here today. Cameron Benia was giving a talk on transport in tungsten phosphor 2, and actually I will probably touch on this. Gil Lanzerich was giving a talk on, I don't remember what, but we did talk about transport, and also two other people, Catherine Pipa, she was giving a talk on quantum criticality, and Indranil Pol was talking about electron spin phonon R coupling in iron-based superconductors. And there is one more person who is not with us anymore, but he's well known to the senior members of this audience. This is my PhD advisor, Pierre Levinson, and all I learned from transport, I learned from him and many other things to which I'm eternally grateful. And his book on transport is the classic, so if you really want to learn something about transport, go and find this book. I listed here a kind of random our collection of references, which I think form the basis for understanding transport. I will put these our slides online so you can take these references. And in brackets, I specified what particular reference can be useful for, because we'll be touching upon different aspects. And the last two, they are not that informative, but that's something which I wrote in a collaboration with some people here, and at least I'm supposed to know what these papers say. All right, so what is the challenge we facing in condensed metaphysics. There are many, but one of them is that there is a large number of conducting compounds, loosely speaking metals, that do not conform to the predictions of the Fermi liquid theory. That is, if we look at scaling, for example, of the specific heat or the spin susceptibility of the resistivity, they scale with temperature, with frequency, in some way which is not in agreement with predictions of the Fermi liquid theory. And among these violations, the transport data perhaps is perhaps the most extensive and abundant, because you can do many things, and you can do it without spending millions of dollars on, for example, synchrotron or ARPIS. But they are notoriously difficult to interpret. And one of the reasons is that there are additional conservation law, which is momentum and velocity, which you need to figure out before you can claim that your particular non-Fermi liquid model produces other resistivity which you see in other experiment. And as a result, the outcome of your theory is usually not an intrinsic property of a Fermi liquid, but it shows you how your Fermi liquid or non-Fermi liquid couples to reservoir, which sinks energy and momentum. And so sometimes we cannot get the information about the intrinsic interaction in the system because we have to worry about things such as disorder, lattice, phonons, etc. Okay, so this is an outline. My lectures roughly split into three parts, and I shamelessly borrowed a terminology from Sean Hartnell, who was speaking on coherent transport last week during the workshop. The first part is going to be a coherent transport of coherent quasi-particles. That is basically how transport of Fermi liquid look like. Then I will make one step forward. I'll be talking about coherent transport of incoherent quasi-particles. So there are situations when you cannot define quasi-particles as well-defined objects, but you can still talk about coherent transport, which is characterized by some time. And a particular example I'll be talking about will be a metal which is tuned to a proximity of the ferromagnetic or quantum critical point. I hope you still have some recollection of Professor Chubikov's lecture in mind from yesterday. So he was mentioning this two paradigmatic a scenario of quantum critical point, ferromagnetism and anti-ferromagnetism. In this part, I'll be focusing on ferromagnetism. And then basically, I will switch to a mode when I will be mapping out problems and puzzles rather than telling you why, for example, the high temperature superconductors have linear resistivity in normal state. I don't know, and I think no one knows, but the best I could do is to formulate the equations. All right, so just a reminder of the Fermi liquid theory. Since we'll be talking primarily about the scattering rate, let me just jump to the argument, which is usually ascribed to Landau, although I think in his first letter, in his first paper on Fermi liquid theory, he says, as it is well known, and then he quotes this formula. So this formula tells you that if you try to organize a collision of two fermions whose energies are distributed according to the Fermi-Dirac distribution, there is what is called Pauli blocking. That is, you can only use the states in the vicinity of the Fermi energy and in the interval of its temperature. And because you have two of those, it's like multiplying probabilities, and so the width of each energy interval being squared gives you a T squared dependence of one over tau. I would also like to emphasize that actually this is not really an outcome of the Fermi liquid theory. This is an input. What you say is that by this argument, the quasi-particles in our Fermi liquid live long times because as you go to low and lower temperatures, the lifetime goes infinite. And based on this argument, I say, well, now I'm going to treat them as free particles. So the Fermi liquid theory is really a theory of free quasi-particles. Okay, that's my range, actually, of my transparency. Okay, so what allows you to do, it allows you to replace an ensemble of strongly interacting particles, such as helium-3 atoms or electrons in the solid, by an ensemble of essentially free particles, but with different parameters. So these particles will tend to be heavier as a rule. They may have a different a G factor. And the Fermi liquid theory allows you to formulate every property of a Fermi liquid as of a Fermi gas of these particles. Sometimes it's kind of better to think in real space rather than in the energy momentum space. So I just wanted to highlight one fantastic feature of a Fermi liquid, which you get by looking, for example, at helium-3. So helium-3 is a canonical example of a Fermi liquid, and it is a liquid. It's not a gas, okay? It has a surface tension, you can pour it out, which means that the interatomic distances are on the same order as the size of an atom. It's dense in this sense. Now, suppose that we take helium-3 and we heat it up to temperatures which are larger than the Fermi energy, but smaller than at the boiling point, so it is still liquid. And then actually we would find that viscosity of this liquid is not that dissimilar to viscosity of any classical liquid such as water. And it changes with temperature exponentially, which tells you that if temperature goes down, you have tendency to freezing. Now, it's not really practical here to talk about mean free pass, but if you do want to talk about mean free pass, it's going to be on the order of the interatomic distance because the atoms are packed. Okay? So, one atom moves by one or two interatomic distances and run into another atom, right? So now suppose that we cool the same system, the same liquid, to temperatures which are smaller than the Fermi energy. And because of the argument which I gave you on the previous slide, the mean free time becomes long, but in real space it means that the mean free path becomes long and becomes much longer than the interatomic distance. So think about it this way. You have dense liquid, a particle starts motion, but it goes through over distances which is much longer than the interatomic one. And so that's the property of Pauli principle. It tells particles that you cannot really interact with your neighbor, although you see your neighbor. You have to make sure that the energy of this neighbor is in the right interval. And if your energy is not in the right interval, I will bypass you, and I will go to the next neighbor. I will bypass him, and I will go to the next neighbor. And then finally, I will find the neighbor in the right energy interval. And viscosity of a Fermi liquid will be like viscosity of air in this room. It's going to be proportional to the mean free pass. Oops, sorry. And the mean free pass is 1 over T squared. And that's what some of other experiments done on actually conducting systems show. All right, so of course, the original theory of Fermi liquid was developed for a Galilean invariant system with isotropic interactions in neutral particles, while in a condensed matter, we deal with electrons in solids, and they're also charged. So we have somehow to make a mental jump from a system with an isotropic Fermi surface, which harbors neutral fermions, to a system where the Fermi surface can look like that, or even like that. This is copper, this is a niobium, and at the same time, we need to take into account long-range Coulomb forces. And this procedure has not been ever done rigorously. What we have is something which is known under the name of anisotropic Fermi liquid. That is, it is a belief that if we morph our Fermi surface in this particular way, and we keep the Coulomb interaction, the physics will not change much. And by and large, this is true, okay? But here are the pitfalls which I mentioned before, and I will walk you through these pitfalls. All right, so in the original Fermi liquid theory, as formulated by Landau, the quasi-particles are just free. This is Fermi gas theory. And the predictions are made only for the thermodynamic properties. Specific heat, which is predicted to be abnormalized by an interaction in a proportion to the ratio of the masses. The spin susceptibility, for example, is abnormalized because you have abnormalization of the G factor and of mass. And these abnormalizations are protected and follow from certain symmetries which we have. This would be Galilean, SU2, and U1, and U1 symmetries, and all of them we have in a system like our helium-3. When we go to metals, we first lose a Galilean because we have lattice, and quite often we also use SU2 because of a spin orbit interaction. So what we really have is U1, and certainly point groups. Then, formally, we can make predictions which look similar to what we have before, but now the prediction would be that the mass is going to be abnormalized with respect to the band mass. And the band mass is not the mass of a free electron. So we need to know this band mass. We need to rely on DFT to tell us what would be this mass without other interactions. And so in this way, the prediction becomes less quantitative compared to helium-3. And this is hard to quantify, and this is why people turn to transport, because in order to have transport, you need to bring in some residual interaction between R quasi-particles. You need to take into account their scattering. And what is usually considered to be a hallmark of the Fermi liquid behavior is that the T-squared dependence of the scattering rate is being translated automatically in the T-squared dependence of the resistivity. And this is one of the pitfalls I'm going to walk over. All right, so this is just to remind you how the resistivity of a conventional or Fermi liquid metal look like. This is a very old plot. This is aluminum. And this is pure aluminum, of resistivity as a function of temperature. And then you add 0.5%, 1%, 3% of manganese. Aluminum by itself is a superconductor. You see a superconducting transition, but then you kill a superconductivity by magnetic impurities, and you study the normal state of resistivity. So there are two regions at low temperatures and at high temperatures, which we understand well. At low temperatures, the resistivity is determined by disorder, chemical, substitutional, etc. At high temperatures, the resistivity in conventional metals, again, is determined by a scattering at phonons. And phonons at these temperatures, much larger than, higher than the debye temperature, behave as classical bosons. The number of bosons in a mode with frequency omega d is proportional to temperature. Well, the resistivity is proportional to the number of these phonons, so the resistivity is linear in temperature. That's a very simple argument. And then in between this constant region and the region of linear behavior, we have a region where resistivity is obviously nonlinear. Theory tells us that it should be a combination of two terms, T squared and T to 5. T squared is coming from electron-electron. T5 is coming from electron-phonon, right? To tell you the truth, it's not very easy to disentangle the temperature dependence here and really show that it follows the sum of these power laws, because the interval, as you see, is fairly narrow, okay? But that's lore. It is supposed to be this way. Okay, so this is the same aluminum, but on a smaller temperature scale, and you see that the resistivity is linear as a function of T squared. So we do map out the first term. Okay, the range of variations is not too big because this is T squared. More of this. This is a heavy fermion compound, which is a heavy Fermi liquid. I don't remember the electron mass in this particular compound, but they can run up to 1,000 of electron mass, which is the mass of a proton. Okay, and again, at very low temperatures, this is below 100 of millikelvin, we do have the confirmation of T squared law. So everything is fine, everything is harmonious. As in this Botticelli painting of Madonna, it's beautiful, it's proportional, harmonious, right? But then we go to something which is known under the name of bad, strange, strongly correlated, non-Fermi liquid metals. Okay, and there are certain characteristic features of this strangeness. This is the system I will spend some time later on. This is palladium, which is doped with nickel. Actually, sorry, the other way around. It is palladium, which is doped with nickel. So palladium is intrinsic metal. It is on the verge of ferromagnetism, but it doesn't quite make it there. It remains a paramagnet. But if you add a little bit of nickel atoms, which have magnetic moment, it does go ferromagnetic. And it does so at a particular concentration of nickel atoms, 2.6% in here. And you can measure the resistivity for different dopings. And the claim is that if you do it precisely at the doping where you are at the quantum critical point between a paramagnet and ferromagnet, the resistivity scales as t to the power of 5/3, not 2. This is a probably better known example. This is just one of the many plots of the resistivity in a particular high temperature superconductor. And this is the famous linear scaling of the resistivity, to which I will also come back later. This is a heavy fermion compound, which is famous for being able to produce a linear of resistivity down to millikelvin range. From time to time, people say, well, what's so strange about the linearity of resistivity? Because I just told you that aluminum has linearity of resistivity, right? But aluminum has it above its adiabatic temperature. Well, maybe there is some soft mode. Maybe at adiabatic temperature is not 100 Kelvin, maybe it's 10 Kelvin. When it goes down to millikelvin, there is no way you can explain the linearity of scaling by electron-phonon interaction. So this is kind of a poster child of forget about phonons. Okay. This is a compound which is very interesting because it really doesn't do anything, and except for very low temperature superconductivity at about one kelvin. Aaron Kapitulnik in his talk was telling you about the time reversal symmetry signatures of in this R compound, but above one Kelvin, this is a vegetable. Doesn't have any phases, but it is a non-Fermi liquid vegetable in the sense that it does show you a T squared R behavior of resistivity at sufficiently low temperatures, which then turns into a linear, and they went to 1200 Kelvin, and as you see, it goes without any signs of R saturation, and in the process of doing so, it steps over what is called Mott-Ioffe-Regel R criterion, which can be defined in somewhat different way, but what it tells you that the mean free path becomes shorter than either the wavelengths or the interatomic spacing. So you can cook up three versions of this criterion, and you will step over all of them in this material and not only in this one. And now, this is like another Madonna. This is Madonna Hololunga, the long neck. And it's also beautiful in its own sense, but look at the proportions. It's all distorted. So it's called long neck because the neck is very long, right? And there is, of course, a baby Jesus in here, but also look at this child. We don't make our babies like this. And then there's a pillar in here. And this pillar is roughly the same size as Madonna, et cetera, et cetera. So this is actually Parmigianina. Those of you who went to Florence last week and had the chance to see this painting in the Uffizi, this is at the beginning of Mannerism. And the strange metals, they're beautiful, as are this Madonna, but they're also strange. Okay, this plot was shown, I think, several times during the workshop. This is to emphasize that the linear scaling of the resistivity is ubiquitous. Not only you see it in conventional metals, aluminum, copper, silver, where we think we know that it's coming from electron phonon scattering, but also in a bunch of other materials, heavy fermions, organics, high temperature superconductors, iron-based superconductors. But the claim, which comes from Andy McKenzie group, is now more quantitative. Not only it is linear in temperature, but if you convert your resistivity into 1 over tau by using some version of the Rudolph formula, then the prefactor in 1 over tau, which is this dimensionless number alpha, is actually not just order of 1, which can mean from 0.5 to 5, let's say, it is actually near 1, with an interval between 1 and 2. And that's all we can say about it. Totally mysterious. I think Sean Hartnell has some ideas about it, which go under the name of bounds. I will probably spend some time on this later on. But we are still in the part of the talk when I'm talking about coherent transport of our coherent quasi-particles and how do we want to describe transport. Well, it's all very complicated. You need to know Boltzmann equation. You need to know Kubo formula. How about the good old Rudolph formula, which we all know? Okay, this is the same picture which Andrei showed you yesterday. This is Paul Drude, and this is his model, which, as you certainly know, is nothing more than the second law, complemented by the frictional term, which is responsible for scattering. So you pull electrons with electric field. That is your MA is equal to the force, but the force has a pulling part and the frictional part. What is tau? We don't know. Okay? Actually, Drude thought that tau is due to scattering of electrons from ions and a lattice, because the Bloch theorem was not proven yet. So now we know that this is due to scattering from deviations of ions from the equilibrium R positions. Now, if you want to solve the DC case, we just say that the time derivative is equal to zero. Here is your velocity proportional to electric field. We plug it into the current, which is charge times number density times the velocity. Out comes your conductivity. All right, if you think that this is simple, I'm going to fool you, specifically, deliberately. I'm going to give you a totally false argument, and I will ask you to figure out what goes wrong. So there is something which is known under the name of Bloch-Drude model. And it's in some textbooks. Drude thought about electrons as free, with a dispersion of p squared over 2m. Well, we now know that we have Bloch wave functions, we have bands, right? And we still know that in the absence of scattering, we have a semi-classical equation of motion, which tells you that still decay dt with an h bar is equal to the applied force. Okay, that works. And that's how we study our dynamics of electrons in solids. But let me put in the same frictional term as Drude did, which is proportional to the same h bar k at the momentum over some tau. I will also solve it in DC, right? I will find the component of the wave number along the direction of the field. And then, instead of doing what Drude did, I will say that the velocity, the zr component of it, is not kz over m, but because I have a lattice of this kind, for example, this is the derivative of the dispersion with respect to the wave number. I will calculate the velocity as a function of kz. I'll plug in the value of kz, and then I will find my current as charge, number density, and velocity. Done. I have related the current to the electric field. Who needs Boltzmann or who needs Kubo? Well, let's apply it to a simple case of a one-dimensional time-bending model. Forget about localization and all this stuff. So we just want to study the motion of electron in a time-bending model with some friction. So this is my dispersion. This is my R velocity. I solved for k on the previous slide. I will plug it in. So now our velocity is a periodic function of the field, but I want to do what is called linear up response. I want to do the weakest electric field as possible. So I'll replace the sign by its argument. And here you go, you have the velocity, which is a proportional to electric field. Now I will do the same as Rudy did. I will multiply this velocity by charge, number density, and I will read off my conductivity, which will be proportional to tau, as in the Rudy formula. It will be proportional to number density, and lattice constant. Done. What's wrong with this? At small number densities, the conductivity is small. At large number densities, near the bottom of the band, the conductivity is large. But I almost filled my band. It's an insulator. Not in Rudy model. Well, Fermi statistics is where I'm putting my Fermi energy. Okay. And we certainly feel that this is wrong, right? And we also feel that the correct result for the conductivity should be that when we are in almost empty band, it's a small conductivity. When it's almost full, it's also small conductivity. And the maximum in this model is at half filling. Okay? And where is the mistake? It's in here. On the lattice, I don't know what number density is. Full number density, in this case, it's equal to 1 over lattice, R spacing. It doesn't mean that the whole number density participates in transport. And the right result can be only obtained if you solve, even in the simple case, a Boltzmann equation. Then you will see the maximum of the conductivity at half filling. All right, so there is no way to get around for of getting into a Boltzmann equation or using the Kubo formula. Okay, so there's one more thing which is normally associated with the Rudy model, but it comes on top of it, and this is called the Mott-Ioffe-Regel rule. Namely, if I would rewrite the result for the conductivity in terms of the resistivity is going to be proportional to 1 over tau, to the scattering rate. And if I have several scattering mechanisms, impurities, phonons, electron-lecton, then we understand that their rates should add up, because the more of them we have, the smaller should be the conductivity, the larger is the resistivity. And we tend to think that it can be done in an independent way. So this is called the Mott-Ioffe-Regel rule, which is actually pretty much R confirmed. But when you start to think about electron-electron interaction, it fails you. And according to this rule, you should just add up all sources of scattering. Well, if you go to low temperatures so that you can forget about phonons, the only two sources of scattering which you have is impurities and electron-electron interaction. So let them up. And we saw the Landau formula for the scattering rate, which is proportional to T squared. So let's lump in it into the resistivity. Simple. But it's based on something which is called SCA. You know what SCA is? Like RPA, SCA. Oh, it's a spherical Kao approximation. What we did, we took our Fermi surface of a metal, and we morphed it back into sphere because we wanted to use second law. And if we wanted to use second law, we have to recall that the second law is based on Galilean invariance. And because of that, the internal forces do not affect the motion of the center of mass. And if we forget about it, then we will recall the story of Baron Munchausen. So for those who read this tale, you know what it's about. For those who don't, this was a fictitious hero, a hunter and a hero in many other ways, but the tales which he used to tell about himself were somewhat more than what he actually did. And one of the tales was that when he was hunting, he got stuck in a swamp on his horse, and being so strong, he pulled himself and his horse out of the swamp by his hair. Okay? Internal force cannot do that. Well, this is just the algebraic formulation of this principle. if we have an equation of motion in our solid with a spherical Fermi surface, we have external force, we have forces of electron-electron interactions, but they all add up to zero when we sum up the equations of motion in the particles, such that the center of mass doesn't know anything about other forces, and in the presence of steady-state electric field, it's going to be accelerated in such a way that the momentum is going to be proportional to time. So now we need to think how we bring in a lattice which breaks Galilean invariance. And there are three ways in which a lattice can provide, can render the conductivity finite. One of them is Umklapp. The other one is Baber or interband scattering. And the third one, which is not that widely known, is that you can actually get away with just having anisotropic Fermi surface, but you need to add disorder. But if you ask a more detailed question, if you have only these R processes and nothing more, no phonons, no disorder, can you get finite conductivity due to either of these three? And the answer is yes for Umklapp. You don't need anything else. For interband scattering, it's somewhat more subtle, and yes, no. And it depends on whether you have a generic multiband metal or you have what used to be a special case, but actually this is now a very common case of a compensated semi-metal with equal number of electrons and holes. In the first case, the answer is no. You need to bring in some other agent, phonons or disorder. And in the second case, the answer is yes. If you are compensated, bismuth, graphite, iron-based superconductor in its parent state, then you don't need to bring anything else. And if you just play the game with an anisotropic Fermi surface, no, you need to bring something else. Okay, so first, Umklapps. Again, this is, I'm bringing you to solid state one. Umklapp scattering is scattering of either two phonons. That's actually how it was formulated by Pyrrhus in 1921, who was thinking about a similar paradox in thermal conductivity of insulators. And then up later on, it was brought into a context of charge transport by Landau and Pomeranchuk. The word is German and it means jumping over. So you're jumping over a fence in this case, and the fence is at the boundary of the Brillouin zone. So because you have lattice in the system, your wave function is not a Fleeting wave function. It has certain symmetry. It is periodic in real space. And therefore, your momentum is not really a well-defined quantity. You can only speak about quasi-momentum, which is defined modular an integer number times the reciprocal lattice vector in this one-dimensional case. So then in general, the momentum R conservation law in a solid looks like this. You have two particles which come in with momentum K and P. They go out with K prime and P prime, but you can add an arbitrary number of reciprocal lattice vectors. If n is equal to zero, this is your normal process, which can also happen, but by itself, it does not contribute to the resistivity. If n is not equal to zero, this is your Umklapp, and by itself, it does contribute to the resistivity. Okay, so what enters A is a combination, as you said, of two probabilities, normal and Umklapp. Because, and it works in such a way, if I remove all Umklapp and keep only normal, A will be zero, right? But if I keep Umklapp, this R coefficient is going to be affected by normal scattering as well, because there is an interference of two processes. No, I can repeat.
Yes, I should say that if you have pure metal, for example, alkaline metal, so the temperature will not be T square, and it will be exponential.
Coming to this. Okay, this is my next slide. No, actually, sorry. I'm coming to this in two slides. Because the rest of the discussion is based on a Boltzmann equation, I need to introduce the Boltzmann equation, and we're going to stay with it for a while. So in the Boltzmann equation, we describe a system of, let's say, many electrons by the distribution function, which is in some sense a probability of finding an electron with momentum k at point r in space and at time t. And because we have something which depends on the momentum and the distance, you can tell that the nature of this approximation is semi-classical. All the observables which we want to know, such as number density, charge current, thermal current, are the averages of the distribution function with weights either given by 1 for number density, the velocity times charge for the electric current, or the energy times the velocity for the thermal current. The left-hand side of the Boltzmann equation is nothing more than the Liouville operator, which describes the evolution of the distribution function in space and time in the presence of the classical force. I'm giving you a very simple version of what is called a gas Boltzmann equation. We'll talk later about the modifications in the case of Fermi liquid. And if particles would not interact with each other, the right-hand side of the Boltzmann equation would be equal to zero. So the right-hand side captures the information about their scattering. It's known as a collision integral. And it describes scattering events of various types. For example, if we want to consider a scattering disorder, which is elastic, then the collision integral is proportional to the deviation of the actual distribution function from its average value. Typically, what not you see in the textbook. What you see in the textbook is that this is the deviation of the distribution function from its equilibrium value. This is right because electron impurity scattering alone cannot form equilibrium. It is elastic. But for all practical purposes, you can replace this average F by an equilibrium F. Or what we'll be modeling with, there is a collision integral due to electron interaction, which is nothing more than an algebraic representation of this picture. When you have two electrons, momenta k and p, they go in, they go out with k prime and p prime. There is some probability of the scattering process, which you certainly need to be calculated separately. But the statistics of this process goes in as the product of the Fermi functions. There are two Fermi functions which tell you that in this particular process, the states k prime and p prime must be occupied, but the final states must be empty. And there are also two delta functions which reflect momentum conservation law. So in here, I also added the reciprocal lattice vector to take account umlaut. And finally, there is energy conservation. Okay, so we'll be interested in weak electric fields. And actually, I don't think that in this talk I will touch on magnetic field. So in this case, we would say that the perturbation on the equilibrium function produced by the electric field is small. And I can parameterize this perturbation by this unknown function g. And just for our convenience, I'll pull out a factor of temperature and the derivative of the Fermi function. Why? Because I can, right? Because my function g is arbitrary, but it pays in later analysis to make formula simpler to pull out these factors. Now, the product of the electric of the classical force times the momentum gradient of F is now the electric field times the same derivative. But because my electric field is weak, I can forget about the deviations of this function from the equilibrium one. So I will put an index 0 in here, right? And then I will recall that the derivative that this function depends on momentum only through the dispersion. I will differentiate with respect to dispersion, and the derivative of the dispersion will give me the actual group velocity of electrons on my given lattice. Okay. Chain rule. All right, so then in this form, the left-hand side becomes somewhat more palatable. And if I do a planarization of the non-linear collision integral for electron-electron collisions. It's non-linear because I have autocollide four particles. But if I do a linearization, that is, I will expand this in the deviations from the equilibrium, I will form this nice combination of the non-equilibrium parts of the Egyptian function, or each with the momentum of the corresponding incoming fermion. And then I will have a bunch of Fermi functions, and then I will have the same R probability. What's really important for the rest of this argument is to have this nice R combination of the equilibrium parts of F. All right, so now why do we need umklaps in the first place if we don't have anything else? Suppose that I disallow umklaps for one reason or another. Then the momentum R conservation law becomes the conservation law of actual momentum. There is no shift by an arbitrary number of the reciprocal lattice vectors. And suppose, so I'm also looking at static case, DC R conductivity, and at a uniform electric field. So I delete the time derivative and I delete the spatial derivative. My left hand side is a known R quantity proportional to the field, and here I have something which I need to solve for. And suppose that I solved it. Suppose that somehow, lo and behold, I found a R solution of this integral equation. Let me call G with index 1. But then I can add any function which is a scalar product of the momentum and any constant, because this guy by itself will nullify the combination of G's in here. If I add something which is proportional to K and something which is proportional to P with the same constant, minus K prime minus P prime, take out this constant vector, and you'll have K plus P minus K prime, but I have the conservation law. Okay? So in mathematical terms, it means that I don't have a unique solution. In physical terms, I can say that I can choose this vector C to be infinitely large, and therefore, because the deviation from the equilibrium controls the magnitude of the current, I can produce an arbitrary large current with an arbitrarily weak electric field. That means that my conductivity can be arbitrarily large, and that is infinite. Okay. So that's why, if we have only electron-electron interactions, we do need umklaps. And notice that the argument here is not for a Galilean invariant system. I did not say that my Fermi surface is a sphere. My Fermi surface is parameterized by the velocity, which is some group velocity of a Bloch electron, right? Of course, I need to work hard to find the scattering probability of this Bloch electrons, but the statement is true for any Fermi surface. Okay, so we need umklaps, but they don't come for free. We need to satisfy two conditions. One of them is in textbook, the other one, I think, is not. So first of all, of course, we need to have a rather large Fermi surface. We need to organize a scattering event in which the difference between the initial momenta and the final momenta is equal to the reciprocal lattice vector, that is the size of the Brillouin zone. Well, let's say B is a euro, and K, P, and K prime, and P prime in magnitude are 1 cent. I cannot do it, right? I need to have enough change in order to change my dollars or my euros in coin, and in particular two-dimensional case, I need to make sure that the maximum of this difference is larger than the reciprocal lattice vector, which means that the Fermi surface has to be large enough, Kf in some sense has to be larger than a quarter of the Brillouin zone, only then I can have umklaps scattering. If I don't have this, the probability of umklaps scattering will be exponentially suppressed, and resistivity would not follow T squared. It will be exponential in temperature, right? And this is seen, or was seen, in ultra-pure alkaline metals back in the 60s, I believe. But there is, okay, so, and the second one is actually that we need to have a sufficiently short-range interaction. That is, we need to think about screen Coulomb and the screening lengths of the Coulomb interaction better be not to be much different from other Fermi wavelengths. Both of these are conditions are satisfied in conventional metals. You have large Fermi surfaces. You have large number of electrons. The screening lengths is short on the scale of the Fermi wavelengths, which is the same as the interatomic distance. So there is no problem to get umklub, for example, in aluminum. On the other hand, you have semiconductors. If electrons there are degenerate, then you can talk about a Fermi liquid here, but the Fermi surfaces tend to be very small because we get these electrons by doping. So in semiconductors, for example, in two-dimensional electron gases, there is no way to get umklub for the first reason. But if we also have long-range interaction in the system, then umklub scattering is suppressed. I will tell you why in a second, but what are the examples of systems with long-range interaction? There are some systems which were also mentioned during the workshop. For example, strontium titanium oxide, STO, which has a huge dielectric constant of 25,000 because it's almost ferroelectric. Now you can imagine that the charge which you put into this insulator, its magnitude is going to be divided by 25,000, so the Coulomb interaction is very weak. That also means that the screening of this interaction by other electrons is also very poor, and the screening length is going to be long. But more in line with strange metals, I will argue that the effective interaction which electrons experience near a particular type of a quantum critical point, in general, nematic, that is a quantum critical point into a state with uniform order parameter, is also very long range. Why? Well, because you interact via an exchange of fluctuations of the incipient order parameter, and this is second order continuous quantum phase transition, and is any quantum phase transition as you approach it, the correlation length becomes longer and longer, and that sets the scale of your interaction. And this is going to be relevant for a few examples which I'm going to be talking later. Okay, so why is it so? Why long-range interaction is bad? Suppose that I want to organize an umklub scattering event on this rather a generic Fermi surface. It's a, let's say, time-bending model above our filling. I need to justify the conservation law that k plus p is equal to k prime plus p prime plus b, but I have an extra condition that scattering can only occur by small change in other momentum. Okay, so let's choose, for example, the change between the initial momentum k and final momentum k prime to be small. Let's make it just equal. Let's say k is equal to k prime. I still need to satisfy the conservation law such that now the difference between the other two momenta, p and p prime, has to be large. It has to be equal to the reciprocal lattice vector. So if I make this electron to scatter by small angle, to compensate the other electron has to scatter by very large angle. But if you look at the Fermi surface, you realize that you cannot do it between two generic points on the Fermi surface. You can do it only on a subset of special points where the Fermi surface intersects at the brilliant zone. So you have umklub hotspots. And then the scattering rate, in this case, is going to be suppressed in proportion to the volume of the area of the spots. And what you see is not a T squared, but T squared are multiplied by something small, and the small near quantum criticality will be also temperature dependent, so you wouldn't get the interesting temperature dependence of the resistivity, you'll get something subleading. If we suppress umklubs, let's say by this argument, then we need two things. We need either a compensated semi-metal, or disorder to render the conductivity finite. Why? Well, because I told you that if we only have electron-electron interactions on a lattice, but without umklaps, the conductivity is still infinite. Okay, so that was umklap. Let's move on to the second error possibility. This is Baber scattering. It goes back to the name of Baber, 1937. And I'm going to do it at a very simple level. So I told you that it's not a good idea to use a spherical cow approximation for a metal, but one can use approximation of two spherical cows. So if I have a two-band metal, or multiple for me means two, okay, that would work. I will morph the actual Fermi surfaces back into spheres. You'll tell me that, well, I distorted my Galilean invariance and I'm subject to all the penalties which I'm supposed to incur. But the very fact that I have two bands violates Galilean invariance. Empty space has one band with dispersion p squared over 2m, period. So if I have two bands, it means that somewhere I brought in lattice. Yeah, I produce a different type of electrons, number one and number two. Okay, so then the Galilean invariance is broken. But because I'm going to use a parabolic model for each of the bands, I will get away with the Drude model, in which I will have the usual MA term, the pulling force, and I will allow myself to treat the charges E1 as E2 as parameters, which will be equal to plus minus E. Then I will have intraband abrelaxation. Think about disorder, for example. But in addition to the single band case, I will have a frictional force, which is of the Stokes type. So the change in the momentum is proportional to the difference of the velocities between the two bands. If the two flow at the same speed, there is no force. But once they start to move at different speed, then there is a frictional force. It's also proportional to the number density of other band. And there is some phenomenological R coefficient, which from a detailed Boltzmann equation we know is, in the Fermi liquid case, proportional to T squared. So there are two cases. One is when the signs of the charges here are the same. Positive or negative doesn't matter. It can be two electron bands or it can be two hole bands. And in this case, I still need to keep intraband abrelaxation. I still need disorder, for example, of phonons. And the second one is when the signs of these charges are opposite, that's electrons and holes, and N1 is equal to N2, which is a compensated semi-metal, does not require intraband abrelaxation. And it used to be in a very special case. People would think about bismuth, people would think about graphite, other group 5 semi metals, antimony. But actually, if you now scan over the systems of current interest, except for iron superconductors and probably some heavy ferromagnetic metals, everything else is a compensated semi metal. So as long as you have a metal with an even number of electrons per unit cell, even number, this is a compensated semi-metal. So this family is actually wide. Okay? And particular examples, iron-based superconductors in their non-doped state, a variety of wild semi-metals. It's called wild type 2, where the Fermi energy is not at the direct point, but it is actually intersecting other bands. So there are many, many conductors in this class, so it actually pays to think at this case in more detail. Okay, so first, suppose that I have a two-band situation like this. It is a two-band case. It is not R-compensated. And how can I understand the solution of this Boltzmann equation? Well, this friction, which I have between the two bands, is determined by temperature. Right? The higher the temperature, the stronger is electron-electron interaction by the kinetic argument. I don't care whether it's T squared or something else, but the rate, this gamma, which I had in the equation of motion, is somehow proportional to temperature, which means that if I go to zero temperature, this rate drops out. And what I have is two bands, and this is equivalent scheme of two resistors in parallel, because each of them conducts in its own way. It is usually discussed in the context of transition metals, where one of the bands is light, it is an S band, and the other band is heavy, it is a D band. So let's talk about S band and D band. Okay, so at zero temperature, I add up conductivities, not the resistivities, and if the R conductivity of one of the band, which is lighter, is much larger than the other, the conductivity at low temperatures is controlled by the most conducting band. Okay, so this is my up resistivity as a function of temperature. I am somewhere here, and in this case, my resistivity is small in some sense. Now let's go to very high temperature. By going to infinity, I don't mean that I'm going above at the Fermi energy. I will define a little bit what does it mean to be at high temperature. But if we're at high temperature, the interband scattering rate is very high. So this, this frictional force is the strongest force in other system, and it locks two bands together into one system. So now, if I take the momentum from the field, I cannot bypass one of the bands. It will go first into one band, and then, via the frictional force, it will be transferred to the other band. So the equivalent scheme, in this case, are two resistors in series, in which case we add the resistivities. Okay, and this resistivity is going to be determined by the least R conducting band, let's say the other D band. Each of these conductivities and resistivities are determined by intraband of relaxation. So the frictional force drops out at zero temperature because it's too weak. It also drops out at high temperature because it's this too strong. These saturation values at low and high temperatures are determined by intraband interaction. And this, if this is coming from impurities, then you have two limits, two saturation values of the resistivity. Electron-electron interaction takes you from one limit to another limit. Now, if these two limits are really separate, which can happen if the two bands are really different in masses. One is very light, the other one is very heavy, so the ratio of the resistivity here to resistivity here is large, then you can talk about an intermediate asymptotic range where the resistivity follows some power law. So that's one way. But if we actually solve the system without specifying whether we're dealing with two electron bands or two hole bands, we'll find that this upper limit on the resistivity at high temperature contains something which has the units of the plasma of the frequency, so in some sense it is our interband plasma frequency, and it contains the number density of one band times the charge of this band plus number density of the other band plus the charge of this band. So now if I go to the case of a compensated semimetal, where the sum is equal to zero, the upper limit here goes all the way to infinity, so I don't have a bound. But it's probably easier to look at this from the scratch. So now I'm going to the case of a compensated semimetal. It's a DC case, so my time derivative is equal to zero. I have a pulling force, and the pulling force comes in with opposite signs because I have electrons and I have holes. I still have frictional force, but now the number density of the other band is common because I have fixed and common number density. Add these two equations, subtract these two equations, and you will find that the difference of the velocities is proportional to the electric field. I did not solve the problem. I did not find the velocity of band one and velocity band two separately. But in order to find the conductivity, I don't need to, because the current is proportional to the difference of the velocities, and I found it here. And because I found that it is proportional to electric field, I can read off the conductivity from here, which is inversely proportional to the frictional R coefficient, which in the Fermi liquid is going to scale as T squared. So in T squared, the conductivity is one with T squared. And I didn't need any help from disorder, phonons, et cetera, all I had to do is to break a Galilean invariance by saying that I have two bands, doesn't happen in empty space, but also saying that I have perfect compensation. Okay, and the third way to get around of how to bring in electron-electron interaction into transport is to do something like this. So now, I'm looking at an actual Fermi surface, which is complicated, futuristic surface in three-dimensional space. So it is very anisotropic. And I do bring in a disorder to render my conductivity finite. But I'm also going to bring in electron-electron interaction without allowing for umklaps. That's the model. Electron-electron on a given Fermi surface plus disorder. Okay. I will claim that it would be enough to produce a T squared in a Fermi liquid term in the resistivity. However, it will be bounded from above. Now, because I don't have umklap, this electron-electron are part of the collision integral conserves the momentum, which means that if I multiply this integral by the momentum and integrate over all momentum, I will get zero. Why? Well, because imagine that I would restore the time derivative here. Under this procedure, the left-hand side will give me the rate of the variation of the momentum in time, and it better be equal to zero if momentum is conserved. I'm out of range. Okay, now suppose that for a second I have a Galilean invariant system with disorder. In this case, the velocity is just k over m. This is again a definition of a Galilean invariant system. So if my collision integral vanishes upon being multiplied by the momentum, but momentum and velocity only differ by a constant factor of mass, the same will be true if I R multiply the collision integral by the velocity. Velocity is current. Okay. So now if I take my Boltzmann equation, I will multiply the left-hand side and the right-hand side by the velocity, also times charge. The electron-electron part of the collision integral will drop out because of this. But I still have an electron impurity part. It doesn't drop out. If I multiply this by the velocity and integrate, this is the current. Now I can read it backwards. Current is proportional to electric field and tau. So I solved my problem. I found the conductivity. And this conductivity is determined entirely by electron impurity scattering rate. There was no R contribution from electron-electron part of the collision integral. Did I solve the problem what the actual distribution of electron is? No, I did not. Did I solve the problem what the conductivity is? Yes, I did. Okay, so in the Galilean invariant disordered system, electron-electron interactions do not affect the resistivity. Now, in this building, I cannot get away with the statement without some penalty. There are other ways. So this statement is true within the formalism of Boltzmann equation, which is semi-classical, right? There is truth beyond semi-classics. And truth is that the truth is that there are effects which do affect the resistivity due to electron-electron interaction, but they go beyond the level of the Boltzmann equation. There are two kinds of them. One is hydrodynamic type R corrections, which I hope to tell you a little bit later. But the other one are so-called quantum interference effects, and they come into R categories, weak uplocalization, which is a precursor of Anderson localization and the interaction a correction, which is known under the name of Altshuler-Aronov and Zala-Narozhny aligner. What happens here, for example, in weak localization our mechanism, when we talk about Boltzmann equation, there is an implicit assumption that the phase of an electron is being randomized after every R collision. There is no memory, but electrons being quantum mechanical particles maintain the information about their phase. And if we organize a special type of a scattering of a trajectory where we go through the same zigzag path twice, first clockwise and then counterclockwise, clockwise, there will be an interference effect similar to interference of waves, and that will lead to a suppression of the conductivity. It is somewhat more difficult to understand what's going on in the interaction correction, but the ballistic version of it is simpler. This is due to Zala, Alanyer, and Abnarozhny. You can think about it as a interference in scattering from a core of an impurity, which you put into a metal, and Friedel oscillation produced by the same impurity. The total potential acting on the incoming electron is the sum of the two, and the potential of Friedel oscillation being periodic in space has certain interesting property, that is, you get a enhancement or suppression, actually, depending on the effective sign of the interaction of backscattering amplitude. All of this lead to corrections, and they need to be properly taken into account. But the outcome is this: there is a certain scale, which is the impurity scattering rate, right? And my temperature can be larger than the scale or smaller than the scale. This is called diffusive regime, and this is called ballistic regime in this sense, right? So if we compare the Fermi liquid corrections, which is coming from the deviations of the Fermi surface from a sphere, with the interference effects, we will lose in the diffusive regime, that is, at low enough temperatures, but in the ballistic regime, we will win. So it makes sense to talk about our correction to resistivity of order T squared, which you get within the Boltzmann equation, and forget about the limitations of the Boltzmann equation itself, given that your temperature is high enough. Probably better. I have 5 minutes. All right. Yeah. Why don't we stop here, and I'll take questions.